We welcome everyone to practice. This is a call to practice. Beautiful day today around the Bay Area, San Francisco Bay Area, California. Beautiful, gorgeous, gorgeous day. And here we are, and we are called to practice. And we will talk about practice, because this is what is crucial. How do you practice? There is one way to practice, and I speak of this way to practice. And the famous statement of Buddha said, the wise ones are already on the other side. They're talking about this river. Let's imagine there's this huge river, and there's all these people trying to cross this river, okay? And they're building boats. They're looking for materials to build boats. They're trying all sorts of ways to, lots of endeavor to get across this river. They say, if we get across this river, we're going to be enlightened. You know, we're going to be happy. So we have to find a way to get across this river. And so they're making so much effort in all of different ways. And yet the Buddha, with the bodhisattvas, says, on the other side, they say the wise are already on the other side. They're already there. This is the crux of it. You must practice. All of us must practice in the form of, I'm already there. I'm already here. I never left here. The answer is, how did I return? I never left. I never left. I was never in this dream that I dreamed. I was never part of that at all. So all the stuff in the dream happened has nothing whatsoever to do with me. It was just a dream of trying to label the here and the now. It was really just, we're trying to label the unlabelable land. I've always been dwelling in the unlabelable land. The unlabelable land. I never left. I never, ever left. So I'm obviously already here. So all these questions, well, how did I get through the gate? I didn't. I didn't go through any gate. I didn't go through it. I'm beyond enlightenment and unenlightenment. I'm beyond attainment and non-attainment. I've always been beyond attainment and non-attainment. And so we must practice in this way. Already there. There's really no other way to practice that I see is successful. Others can speak for whatever they do, but here we practice in the way I'm already there. There's no graduated effort to get to where we already are. We are here now, except we're trying to label where we're at. And what we're doing is we're honoring all the past efforts to label where we are, which is everywhere. How do you label everywhere? Okay? So we've made so much effort dreaming, as it were, or trying to come up with a way to label what we are, define freedom, absolute freedom, that we tend to honor this. We come into, for instance, let's say, this world. We find ourselves focusing on this world. This world is constantly bowing and worshiping to all the efforts that have been made, and trying to build on that and increase it, and label, trying to label the unlabelable. And we're expected to follow suit. What we are has no label at all. It's absolute freedom. How could there be a label? There can't be a label. There can't be any definition of what we are. And we're already that. I am already that. It's not that I found a label. Oh, so I finally found a label. Oh, okay, finally found a way to label myself, so now I'm happy. No, there is no label for what we are. So we must practice as if I don't have a name, I don't have a label, I don't have a body, I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I don't have any label as to what I am at all. I'm already that freedom, already that freedom. So imagine a huge, massive, monolithic structure going up 50 stories high, all in stone. And on the stone is so many inscriptions and carvings, millions and billions of carvings and decorations and everything. And in the very middle of the structure at the ground, there's an arch, an open arch. And everybody's trying to walk through this opening, this archway in this massive monolithic carved decorated sculpture. Monolithic sculpture, as it were. You know, it's like 200 yards wide and 50 stories high. It's this gigantic structure with this arch, and we go through it. It's all clear there. There's no labels. So we're trying to walk through this arch, and we're looking up, and we're so intimidated by this massive structure and all the decorations and carvings. In fact, they've been working on this for thousands of years. The great craftsmen, artisans and craftsmen have been working on this structure in every way. It's got everyone that's ever been born has got a little figure in this massive rock monolith that you've added a little decoration of a body and maybe a little flower there or something, and it's inlaid with precious stones and everything. And it's so huge, there's room for billions and billions and billions and billions and billions of these little inscriptions, little images in the stone. And it's has all these beautiful inlaid carvings and gleaming with all sorts of beautiful inlaid gold and mother of pearl and diamonds and emeralds and just, you know, it's just this scripture everywhere on it, so much scripture everywhere written on it. We're just like, oh, you know, how can I get through this archway? I have to honor all this. I have to learn all the scripture inscribed here. I have to somehow honor all the decoration. I have to. And so people prostrate themselves to this. They do the prayers, they think, if I just get permission from this, I gotta get permission. Okay, so, and they move a little inch forward, and they inch forward bit by bit by bit. They say, take me a long time, but I honor all the inscriptions, all the little imagery, and say prayers to them and well-beings to them. And I know I'm such a failure. I know I have so much troubles and all this, but still, I still want to get through that arch, and please. So there's all this graduated effort being made. And beyond the arch, there's just this open, beautiful, open, clear field, clear sky, clear field. Oh, we want to get there so badly, but there's still, we're enthralled by just the complexity of this monolith. Wow, such complexity. But what we do is we start with a position that we are resting, calmly resting, already on the other side of this monolith, through the arch. We're already through the arch. We're on the other side of it. We're in this clear, absolute, seamless, endless clarity. And we've always been here. The monolith is a dream. Going through the arch of the monolith is a dream. Some person trying to get through the arch of the monolith is just a dream. It's just a mental projection. We've never left where we are. So there's no how do we get through that arch for us at all. Drop that. Drop all graduated endeavor. How do we attain? How do we get enlightened? All of that is sheer delusion. It's just a dream. How do I get dream enlightenment? How do I get dream attainment? The problem is that the monolith is so intricate. that it's just, you know, it's stunning. Our creativity in carving this monolith, it's just, you know, it's endless. Endlessly creative, is it not? So much carving in the stone of intricacies, telling a story of each life that's ever been here. But it's all a dream. There's no monolith, there's no arch. And yet, for the sake of communication, we say we're already on the other side. And then they say, how did you get there? I've always been on the other side. So the dreamer is not in the dream. Okay, the dreamer's never in the dream. The dreamer is never what is being dreamed about. Never is what is being dreamed about. So there's nothing in the dream that really relates to the dreamer. It was really tells us what the dreamer is at all. Nothing. There's nothing on that monolith that tells us anything about what we are. They're just all labels. So we just accept we're already on the other side of this arch, and there's no story at all about how we got here, none whatsoever. There's no practice we did that got us here, none whatsoever. There's no effort we made that got us here, none whatsoever. There's no failure, no sacrifice we made that got us here, none whatsoever. No failures, no petitioning, no act of God got us here. No miracle got us here. We've never left where we are in the slightest bit. So there's no returning to where we are at all. There's no returning whatsoever. None whatsoever. That's all a dream. It's entirely a dream. So just let the dream gradually like float away like a balloon. Let it be like a helium balloon that's kind of deflated, and so you let go of the cord and it just kind of just sits there. You know, it doesn't go up in the sky and disappear. It just kind of floats right by you. But just let go of it. That's all. You know, those happy birthday balloons, happy graduation day, congratulations, hope you feel better, all these helium balloons. Well, you know, if you let them go, you know, they're going to go up in the sky. They've got a little weight on them to keep them from doing that. So, it's like we have this helium balloon dream. And the dream is like this helium balloon, and it's got a little weight on it, okay, and a cord, a little ribbon or something. And so, but we're holding tight to it, you know, but just let go of it. Just let go of it. It'll just stay right there. Just like that. That's all we have to do. And like a security blanket, a child puts it in their closet. You know, it's still in the closet. Just let it stay there. But we're not making any effort to hold it anymore. We're not attached to it, in other words. We're not attached to our dream at all. Dream's still there, but we're just not attached to it in any way. This is the practice we're called to here. And again, we don't have to attain where we are at all. It's not an attainment, it's a letting go of that balloon. So rather than acquiring something, like obtaining something, like some state or realization, it's the letting go. Relaxing your and letting go, the mind lets go of attachments, all attachments. And that's when we're able to feel, experience where we are, where we already are. How can we experience where we already are if we're desperately trying to hold on to something which tells us we've come from somewhere else? How can we know where we already are and have always been if we're holding on to something, a story of where we came from? Now we all have these elaborate stories. Yeah, I did this, I did this, I did this, I met this. I was on the path for a long time. I did it. And so we have this balloon, the path, the spiritual path. Just let go of it. No path. There's no path. We've always been in a pathless land. There's no path in, there's no path out, there's no such thing as in and out. All our thoughts and thinking and concepts are just labels, trying to label what we are, label the land that we dwell in. The land that we dwell in is the land of absolute freedom. And there's no room for labels in this land. So we always try to shrink away from labels as much as possible, of course, pragmatically, in talking, sharing, communicating here. It seems as though we're using labels, but that's just a pragmatic step. It's not the goal to integrate labels and non-labels. Reality is the pathless land is beyond labels and non-labels. It's beyond labeling and non-labeling. Very important. It's beyond both. It's not like it could be labeled, but we have this discipline to not label it. It's not like we're in this quiet, nirvanic state where we're not labeling, we're avoiding labeling. There's no way to label it at all. So there's not even a question of whether I label or not, don't label, or whether I attain and don't attain. Now, sudden enlightenment is just letting go of our attachments to labeling. That's all. Just taking our hand off of the balloon. Just letting go of that and no more attachment to it. Of course, all the labels, when we take our hand off the balloon, we're not attached to the balloon at all. So there's all labels we let go of at once. Like it was a balloon, trying to separate from what we are. Now, when we do that, we feel what we are, and then we say, "Well, how did I get here?" I took my hand out, dropped all labels. So then we go back and try to label. Okay, the label of we let go of labels, and this is how I got here. No, I didn't get here. I've always been here. I'm experiencing what I am now because I'm not trying to focus on a dream figure that's involved in a dream of labeling. But there's nothing in particular that the dream figure did. No step that it took, no insight that it had, no enlightenment that it had, or anything. No, that's just a labeling device. You know, the body goes around labeling. It's just like a labeling device. Leave everything exactly as it is, this very instant in the dream of labels, and just take your hand off the balloon. So we could see how coming into this world in the natural state, how extremely difficult it is here to be aware, remain in this awareness in the natural state, because everybody here is trying to figure out how to get there. And so if you're in the natural state, they'll bombard you with, how did you do that? How can we do that? There's no doing to it. Just let go of doing. Let go of the balloon of doing. So they say, are you a great enlightened one? No, I'm just exactly the same as everyone else. We're all already here. There's no attainment at all. Neither is there a non-attainment. And there's nothing to tell about any path. No story to tell at all. The mirage can remain, but now we see it as a mirage. This is like the sort of an interesting mirage where usually like we're driving toward the mirage and it keeps receding for us. This, the mirage, keeps coming towards us, keeps coming towards us, keeps coming towards us. But it keeps evaporating, you know, as it gets close to us, it keeps evaporating and it never reaches us. It's like that, like the mirage is driving towards us. And yet the nature of that mirage is such that it never reaches us. And so we're trying to say, come on, mirage, you can reach us. Come on, you can reach us. If I just, you know, do something, it will finally, the mirage will finally reach me. We have to realize that what we are is not reachable. We're freedom. We're no label. We're no thing at all. So how could we be reachable? That's a delusion, that we're reachable. So no matter what we do, we never reach ourselves. We cannot reach ourselves. We're unreachable. We could only be that. We can never reach it. So we can only be freedom. We can never reach freedom. It's impossible. You'd have to label it, right? And of course, there is no label for pure freedom. So all our efforts to reach what we are all in vain. Just a dream, a mirage. We're unreachable. All of us are completely unreachable. Everything is unreachable, actually. So, we're dissatisfied because we're trying to reach instead of be. We're trying to make ourselves reachable. We can never affix labels to us. Say, gotcha. Now I know what you are. You're this. You're reachable. You're some destination I can reach. There's no destination to reach. We're unreachable. So we're already there. No destination to reach. At all. We're unreachable. All of us are unreachable. So there's nobody outside to cry about, say, oh, the poor them, they can't reach us, they're forever, will never know us. There's no one like that. There's no one who's reachable. We're all completely unreachable. There's no one left outside that has to try and reach us and yet never can, and they're left outside. No such situation. So just practice like, I am unreachable. I am totally unreachable. Be that practice. Say, I am unreachable. And we can, if you want to go up a ladder, you say, I can be unreachable. I can be unreachable. I will be unreachable. I am already unreachable. I've always been unreachable. Or you can say, I can consider myself unreachable. I will consider myself unreachable. I already am unreachable. I've already accepted that I'm unreachable. So the effort to reach ourselves, that is the delusion. And yet in this world, it's seen as the spiritual path. And this is, you know, lunacy. It's that which prevents us from recognizing that we're unreachable. How can we accept ourselves as unreachable if we're all on the spiritual path trying to reach ourselves? Of course, we're all tacitly stating and believing that we're reachable. Of course. And this is the delusion. This is the trouble that we're suffering from. And there's some who try to reach the self, and they're supposed to come back and tell the others, you know, who, you know, okay, this is how you reach the self. This is how you do it. So the others are waiting for that information. They may not seem to be on the path, but they're waiting for the information. It's like they sent out some scouts to reach the self. And the scouts are supposed to report back to the ones that are waiting. So the ones that are waiting, of course, they're supporting the notion that the self is reachable. So if the scouts come back and say, guess what, everyone? The self isn't reachable. And they say, what? You're just a bad scout. We don't want to hear that. Now, it's easy to kind of lose track of this. This is why those who are able to suggest practicing this way are so valuable in this world. Rarely do you come across the suggestion to practice in this way. It's almost unheard of. I am completely and intrinsically forever unreachable. God is totally unreachable. We keep thinking we can reach God. God is totally unreachable. We can only be God. God is the unreachableness of reality, the absolute freedom, which can never be defined or labeled. So instead of intellectually hearing this, we practice this. We literally practice this. I am the unreachable self. The one self, the one life, the unreachable one life. The one life is completely unreachable. Just abide in that. Wonderful. I'm feeling a good groove with that. Now it's June 11th, okay. I've had a queasy stomach for about a week. I think it's just the nervousness about you know, the intensity of what we're engaged with here. Say, oh wow, yeah, this is really it, isn't it? Yeah. The one life is entirely unreachable. Immediately I felt recognition there. I said, yes, that's it. We think there's someone outside, and we need to be very solicitous because they're looking for us, and we need to be found. So, because they're not experiencing what we're experiencing, so we say, okay, how can we be found? You know, they need to find us. Our you know, it's like we have some creations that are separate from us, and they need to find us and reach us, and then they'll be they'll know what created them. There's no such creation at all. no creation is ever findable. No creation is ever reachable. The one life is the one. There's just one life, one creation, which is totally unreachable. So it's easy to practice this way, right? You just sit here quietly and just hear it. You don't have to reach it, what's being said. What we are is not reachable. Don't have to attain it. Now, in the dream, everything seems reachable. You reach the edge, do you not? And then you fall off the edge of the table. So everything here, you say, well, you know, there's nothing but reaching. I reach this object over here. I reach that. I reach this. So labeling everything. So it's all labels and all reaching. I go here. I can reach that over there. So we keep training ourselves to believe in reaching, and then we think there's a figure in the dream who's learning how to reach, gradually, progressively, becoming more and more evolved, who will one day be able to reach the self. There's no reaching the self. The self is totally unreachable. So what's the use of dreaming a dream of reaching the self? No use at all, actually. It's just a silly, it's silly silliness. And we make ourselves tired because we think, well, the reason why we're not reaching the self is we're so tired. That's why. If we weren't so tired, we'd reach it. So it's an excuse, a mental excuse, fatigue. It's an excuse for failure. That's why we're failing. You see, we say, no, I can reach it. I'm just too tired to. Or I'm too sick to. Sickness is just an excuse. Or death. Oh, I died before I reached it. These are just all excuses. Dream excuses. That's all they are. That give us excuse for why we're not reaching the self. That's because the self's unreachable. Now, I've never heard of such this kind of talk. It's just coming from my prayers to the Holy Spirit, to Longchenpa, to the Dharma Kings, this morning, really praying for help. I've never read a book that said the self is unreachable. It's impossible to reach the self. I mean, isn't all spiritual teachings say there's a way to reach the self, right? But the truth is no, it's completely unreachable. So this is like a, this is revolutionary teaching, really. And it's like nobody's willing to say this, but I am. Because we're up against this terrible crisis that's coming, where we're going to redouble our efforts to reach the self, to evolve, to reinvest in the dream, so much so, that it's a crisis. If you know that the self is unreachable, and there's this massive attempt to convince you otherwise, that is not a good thing. You do not want that. So again, I've always been the one who's willing to say what no one else is willing to say here in this world. And it's got me in a lot of trouble. I'm persona non grata. I mean, I'm an orphan here because of this. And I've made all sorts of adjustments that got me in trouble. And, it's a very difficult thing to speak in this way here. Because people, it's just the opposite of what they think is wise and intelligent and helpful. The opposite, they think. They think that the teacher is supposed to teach them how to reach the self. And here I am saying, no, the self is completely unreachable. There's no way the self can ever be reached. Nothing can ever reach it. God cannot reach the self. God cannot even reach God. God is unreachable. The self is unreachable. Reality is completely unreachable. And people say, what? So, you don't hear it. You don't hear this very often in such a direct way. We dance around it. Non-dual talk sort of dances around it this a lot. But here we're not even dancing. We might be hopping and a skipping, but we're not really dancing. We're just sitting here and saying this and then wowing it. I know some people say, I never thought I'd hear this in this world. Well, I never thought, I'd say this either. I mean, I keep waiting for someone else. I keep waiting, for these big spiritual bigwigs to say this, and they don't say it. I can't wait any longer, folks, The self is totally unreachable. Absolutely unreachable. And therein lies our salvation. Because we can drop all the attempts to reach it, which in those attempts are what? Just a silly dream of labeling and reaching and not reaching, attaining and not attaining, duality. Right? To reach something, there has to be the possibility of not reaching it, right? There's no such possibility. Reality is neither reachable nor non-reachable. It's beyond reaching and non-reaching. But we can say it's impossible to reach it. This is a way of affirming it's impossible. There is no reaching the self at all. Never has been, never will be. So all of such endeavor is absolutely futile from the beginning. It's absolutely much ado about nothing. And, I get, some positive feedback from a few, but in my whole life, very little positive feedback I've gotten. People just don't, they just like, we don't want to encourage that. So very little encouragement I've gotten, very, very little, but only from these great teachers and dreams and the way they help me in the grace of coming. I came across this prayer to Longchenpa yesterday on YouTube. Wow, what a profound experience that was. It just knocked me out. So again, we want to be knocked out every day. It's so important to somehow don't finish your day until you've been knocked out by truth. And this was this prayer in Tibetan with English subtitles. It had both the Tibetan and the English subtitles, and it was a sung in Tibetan, a prayer to Longchenpa. Wow, was that profound? Oh my gosh, that was the real thing. Experiencing that of how. Guru Yoga, praise to the Guru, and have compassion, have all your, please, shine all your compassion upon me, because I'm so lost in foolishness and silliness, and all my attempts are just, you know, seem to be, you know, of no help whatsoever. It's as if I have not a clue. But what they're missing, and Longchenpa told me after the video, I got this transmission, like said, okay, he said, look, this is all the wrong approach, actually. I don't, you know, who could say that? I mean, who's willing to say that? I have to do it. It's beautiful and wonderful, and I just was just struck by it so much. Because it's basically saying, help, you know, I just can't seem to reach the self. And what they don't get is that the self isn't reachable. This is what Longchenpa is saying, telling us. So they're praying, Longchenpa, how do I reach you? You know, how do I reach you? And he's saying, I'm not reachable. It's like, and then anybody's also saying, neither are you. You have the same unreachable nature as I do. This is what he's trying to get through to all of us. And so I'm willing to say this because I don't really have much to lose. I'm an orphan here. You know, I'm not welcome. I don't have any standing anywhere, actually, in this world. It's not like I have a bunch of friends and families that have good standing. I have no good standing anywhere here. I never have. Not in my own family. I have no standing in my own family. I don't have standing in friends' families or, you know, anywhere. There's nowhere in the world that I have good standing. This is a fact. It is a very tough fact to deal with. I feel most comfortable, I think, in like a hotel, a resort, where the people treat you like an honored guest because they're paid to do so. And at least I feel I have some standing there, even though it's fake, because, you know, you're paying, and so they're trained to treat everyone with like you have like perfect standing here. So that's a very like amazing experience for me I had when I went to this hotel, and the hotel staff is just so immaculately trained and such that they treat you just like, you know, you're the boss. I mean, you have total standing here. Unquestioned standing here. And I'm like, wow, how nice does that feel? Because I have never felt in my life that I have any standing in this world. Never. And I'm always searching for it, you know. Maybe if I make some great songs, people say, oh yeah, we really like you. We got good, you have a good standing with us. No, because they know I have this truth with me that the self is completely unreachable. And that's the last thing they want to hear. They say, oh, well, you don't have any standing with us then, because we're engaged with trying to figure out how to reach the self, how to realize the self, how to actualize the self, how to, you know, like the self is something that is made or something, or evolved. So, you know, Jesus said, there's no room at the inn. Joseph and Mary were looking for a place for Jesus to be born. And there was no, everybody was full up. No, sorry, we're full. And Jesus said, the Son of Man has no place to lay his head here in this world. And this is what he's getting at. It's like, my whole life I felt like an orphan here. This is true. This is why it's been so difficult. Nobody wants to feel like an orphan. And I had this dream long ago where I discovered this infant by the side of the road. And I asked everybody, is this your child? Do you know whose child this is? You know, this is terrible. This is an abandoned child. And nobody would take responsibility. No, we don't know. And finally, I realized it was getting dark, and I said, well, I can't just leave this child here. I'll have to take this child, but I don't know how to raise a child. Nobody will help me. I said, can you help me? Will you? And so then I took it to the city, and I was asking everyone, and nobody, would you take this child? And it's an orphan. No, we can't take that child. I said, but, you know, your social welfare, you won't take this child? No. I could find nobody who would take this child. So I was stuck with this child. I said, wow, this is horrible. I said, I don't know how to raise you because I'm incompetent. You know, and nobody will help me. So you're probably going to be really messed up, maladjusted. And I really apologize in advance that I'm giving you a horrible life, you know. You'll feel like an orphan here in the world. Nobody will befriend you. Nobody will. And so I've raised this child my whole life. And then the child began changing in front of my eyes and turned into this golden light. And I realized this child was the divine child. And nobody here, I was the only one who would, nobody would take responsibility for it. I was, got stuck with it. And I said, well, I'll do my best. I don't think it's going to be good enough for you, but I'll try my very best. And then it revealed itself to me as it was actually the divine child, the true self. So I've been carrying, this true self with me my whole life. But it makes you feel like an orphan here, that nobody wants to help you. Nobody will have anything to do with you. They really won't. They feel that you're going to cause them to fail, like a curse. So people kind of shy away from you, like, whoa, he's going to cause me to fail. I say, what? I'm just trying to share the gospel with you, the good news. You don't have to keep trying to reach the self. You already are that. But that's not understood here. It's not accepted here, except for a few. Except for a few fortunate few. And it seems to be that way in any age, that there's just a fortunate few who matriculate and recognize, wow, all these ages are much ado about nothing. And I might as well then just see it as just decoration, right? Because that's all it actually is. That's all it is. There's no storyline to any of it. So you might as well just see it in the now. It's just decoration in the now. And just appreciate it as just this ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. But as far as a story, anything happening? No, nothing's happening. There's no story taking place at all. It's just this, beautiful mirage, and just see it as that. Now, Longchenpa was, I wouldn't say frustrated, but he simply was aware that not many understood what he was talking about. Jesus, the same. Ananda Mahima, the same. Ramana Maharshi, the same. Very few, they always take it like they're looking for some advice of how to reach the self. So everything they say, okay, I almost get it, kind of get it. Right? So I've got to, how do I use this advice to reach the self? And Ramana said, moksha is realizing that you've never been born. That's the real liberation. I spent a lot of time with Ram Maharshi. Again, I can't advise this highly enough. If you're one of the fortunate few, I have all these pictures with quotes. And I can put all these pictures up on my blog, and you can download them, actually. But I just stop doing it because nobody does it. It's like, it's a lot of effort and nobody responds. But if you get all these pictures with quotes from Ram Maharshi and put them in a folder, one folder on your computer, and then go into Screensaver and select Slideshow, and then click Advanced, you can select a folder of pictures to use for your slideshow, and then click, like for me, slow, gives like 10 seconds slow, and just standard transition, just a fade, or just a cut, doesn't matter. And then click, like for me, like every 50, if I don't use a computer for 15 minutes, it goes into the slideshow of Ram Maharshi pictures with quotes. And so whenever I go back to my computer, I'm away for a while, go eat something, do something, I come back, there's the slideshow going. And so I just sit down and I watch it for like 10, 15, 20 minutes. And so all day long, I'm having this 15 or 20 minutes many times during the day. When I wake up in the morning, what's the first thing that sees me? This slideshow from Ram Maharshi is continuously playing on my computer. And I just, in the morning, I wake up to that and I'll just spend time just wow, 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 wow. Wow, wow, wow. I find this is one of the greatest helps possible. And, it's just like, I have this super good advice here, and it just, nobody does it. It's the most extraordinary thing. How to use your computer in a very helpful way. You can have this automatic slideshow click on for you, like this. Automatically, without you having to do anything about it. And it's just there. Oh, thank you. I say, oh, thank you. It's there. I wouldn't have thought of doing that. If you have to actually start a movie on YouTube, you got to go through all this stuff. This is so much easier. It just automatically starts for you. You can set the time interval for whatever you want. You can do this with A Course in Miracles slideshow. I mean, I have slides for that too. That I've put up on my blog. I can put all these pictures, but you have to download it. I don't know how to put pictures in I'd have to host them on my website and then put them in zip format. I don't have that website, but you know, this is something I could, you know, I don't have a website that got paying for it. I don't know, maybe I should just, you know, something that has a lot of space to it and compress it into like a zip file, how to make a zip file, then you could download it, then and then, you know, uncompress that into a folder, and then you'd have all the pictures there for you. But you know, it's better to be just industrious and just like I downloaded them all from Facebook and stuff. It might take you four hours, but what a great way to spend some time downloading these quotes from Ramaharshi, and you see each one as you're downloading it, and it gets builds up expectation, and just download them all. Spend 4 hours doing that. I mean, I spend 3, 4, 5, 6 hours doing stuff, just a project, just boom, all the time. It's worth it. If you're desperate enough, it's worth it. But, you know, it doesn't happen. I have a course in Longchenpa. I could do Ananda Maima. I could do Jesus. I could do all four of our root, you know, Dharma kings. I could, with quotes and pictures, beautiful quotes and pictures, and you could alternate the slideshows. You could, you know, choose a different folder for a week. One week it's Ramana, next week it's Longchenpa. Maybe I will do that. Maybe I'll just do that for myself and then make it available to all of you. But you have to do stuff like this that breaks you out of the mold, where you're easily reminded of this transcendent truth that the self is completely unreachable. Otherwise, you are simply going to be swept away by graduated effort of this world, because this is what the world's all about. It's a place of, it's a resort delusion, you might call it. The delusion resort. And if you want to be really deluded, this is where you come to this world. Wow. And it'll be the same old, same old. Your life will be the same old graduated effort. How do I reach the self? And you'll realize, well, I glimpsed it. I had some breakthroughs here, but I didn't quite reach it. Okay, another life. Maybe I'll reach it. Maybe it was enough. And then you find you have another life. And you do it again, and you do it again, and you do it again. And it goes on and on and on. As long as you're trying to reach the self, you will keep on having the dreaming. You will still believe you're this dream figure. As long as you believe that the self is reachable, you will believe, take yourself to be this body, a dream figure in a world. It'll continue on forever. As long as you keep trying to reach the self, that's how long you will take yourself to be a dream figure in a dream world, and striving and struggling, dying, suffering. All these are just excuses. Suffering, all these excuses. That's it. This is a fact. There's no way around that whatsoever. I don't care if you read all the holy scriptures in the world 1,000 times, say 1,000, you know, 1 billion affirmations, say, you know, supplicate prayers and begging Longchenpa 1 trillion times, begging Jesus, doing A Course in Miracles, you know, for 1 trillion years. As long as you're trying to reach the self, you will still be suffering all these excuses of why you're not succeeding. And you'll believe you're a body that can suffer this, die and suffer and all this stuff. This is a fact, okay? I'm stating the facts for everyone here. What else do I have to do, really? So if you don't practice actually accepting, you're unreachable. You're already where you are, and you're actually completely unreachable. If we don't practice this, we will just continue on decorating futility, really. Decorating futility. Now, this may sound harsh, but what is more harsh is to keep on decorating futility, isn't it? Without anyone telling you the truth. That's even harsher. So we may have to choose between harsh and harsher. What do you choose? Well, I don't have to give you that answer, right? We might have that decision to make politically, you know, between harsh and harsher. Let's just decorate the way we've always decorated. No, let's go on. Let's really start decorating a new way. Well, in this choice between harsh and harsher, you go with, stay with the old way, because we're already used to it, and we've made a lot of progress in detaching from that already. Okay, so we're already kind of saying, you know, this old, all this decorations we made of futility, I'm kind of sick and tired of it. So that's good. So what now? So the choice is, what do? Do I just stick with it, even though I'm kind of sick and tired of it, or do I decide to really work on really changing all the decorations and making them more different? The answer is, you stick with the old decorations, because getting sick and tired of them is great, because now you have this advice that the self is totally unreachable, and then there's a way to practice this, abiding in this. And so it's good that you're getting tired, because it's easier to detach from it and say, I don't even need such a dream. That means you're on the brink of success. So many here are getting close to this breakthrough of accepting the self as totally unreachable, and all our efforts have just been decorating futility. And that's all that's been. It's been much ado about absolutely nothing. And we're close to it. And so we say, hey, look, the last thing we want to do is to jump into some new endeavor of, let's just change everything up, bring a new civilization, do new decorations, you know, the yoga girl thing of let's spiritualize it in a new way and beautifully, let's do this something beautiful, a new decoration. That's the last thing we want to do. That's like extraordinarily harsh. Okay. So this is the idea of being conservative, is you stick with what you've already have and don't try to do anything too new, really. I mean, naturally we will decorate stuff in, you know, styles change, but not radically. We're basically sticking with, you know, what we have for the most part. We're not trying to pioneer a new age at all. Now, some people think A Course in Miracles is trying new age. No, it's not. Not at all. It, in fact, it's helping us not pioneer a new age. It's freeing us from a new age entirely. It doesn't speak of a new age ever. Jesus never speaks of this a glorious new age. He does not. He does not. None of the gurus do. None of the Dharma kings speak of a glorious new age, of, you know, where futility is decorated in just the right way. They never say that, actually. No, they do not. This might surprise some, but I know them all, and they do not speak in this way at all. It's the ego that speaks in this way. Because the ego's scared that we're getting tired of futility. It says, well, we gotta get some better decorators going here. I mean, you know, you guys in the past, you didn't do a very good job, did you? Because you're getting tired of it. You say, I don't know, it didn't really help. Did it help you reach yourself? No? Well, you didn't do a very good job. We got to do a much better job. Let's put some new folks in charge, and they're going to crack the whip. We're really going to decorate futility in the right way. So you're going to finally find yourself. You're going to finally locate yourself. You're going to finally reach yourself. We're going to finally succeed. The new age is when we're all going to finally succeed, and we're going to reach the self and be enlightened and be happy. This is the ego. This is the ego. This is the devil of duality speaking like that. This is what you have to avoid at all cost. And there's so few that are hearing this, listening to this and hearing it. There's so few. It's you know, it's really sad. But what can I do? I have to keep trying. I wish there'd be 1 million views, you know, 10 million views of each video. Just the people to hear this, that's all. And this is the agony, I guess you say, of the Dharma kings, is they know the truth, that the self is completely unreachable. This is what they've been trying to tell us. And it just doesn't seem to matriculate down here sufficiently. But what can they do? Can they change the message? No, they can't. They can't change the message. And it's difficult to teach this here. Say, speak up, because again, you would be your persona non grata. I mean, I don't tell anybody I know what I'm saying, because I'd be totally persona non grata. Like, you're just crazy. What are you talking about? You don't have a clue. You can't. They just say, well, you can't possibly be conveying what Longchenpa has to say, because he couldn't possibly say such a thing. So you must be just making it all up. You must be like just pulling our chains. You must just be a bad person. You're either crazy or a really nasty, terrible person, because you're just trying to get us to fail. And say, no, Longchenpa doesn't want us to fail. He wants us to succeed in reaching the self. So you got it completely backwards. This is what the reaction would be. Always has been, except for a few fortunate ones, that they hear this and they say thank you. They hear it and they say thank you. That's what I've always wanted to hear. This is what I just want to hear. This, but I know it's true, but I just can't say it, because I don't want to be seen. I don't want to be orphaned, you know. And for me, I've already been orphaned. My whole life I've been orphaned, you know. And I've been going through kind of depression over this, because I realize if I speak up like this, just more orphanage, you know, for me. But I decided to speak up. You know, what else can I do? I've kind of been depressed and going through a tough time, because I realize I need to speak up like this, but most people are going to see me in a bad light for doing this. And, you know, I'm so tired of just being an outcast, you know? So I said, Longchenpa, I'll speak up, but let me stay in a hotel for a while, you know? So, I feel that I have at least I can stay here, you know. I said I'll speak up for you. I'll speak up, but realize I can't. You can't speak this to your family. You can't speak this to your friends. You can't speak this to people. They feel like you're trying to sabotage them, and you lose your standing with them. So we'll see what happens to me as far as where I find myself. I don't know. I've gotten some promises that I'll find myself somewhere. Because you cannot speak this way and then rely on the hospitality of others, where like a hotel, I mean, their job is professional hospitality. It's all just, you know, it's an act, but it's an act that they are committed to, and they treat you like, you know, you're the king or the queen, and that's helpful for your confidence. But as far as personal family, personal connections, They feel like you're cursing them, that you're bad luck, because you're teaching, you know, the opposite of truth. They think that truth is we have to learn how to reach ourselves, reach our potential, reach this. There's no reaching our potential. Okay, I'm saying that there's no way to reach our potential. It's impossible. And this, of course, flies in the face of the human potential movement, human growth movement, human potential movement. Everything that's been going on in this world, it absolutely is opposite of what they're saying. And this is the truth that I've been carrying with me my whole life, and it's so difficult to get this out. I think it has something to do with my sick stomach, and it is realizing I got to say this, you know, and what are the consequences for me. I'm saying it, and we'll see what the consequences are. maybe everyone will abandon me here. Maybe not. Maybe not. Maybe not. It's some strong medicine, isn't it? But at least you know somebody's saying it. And so this might, you know, hearten you, you know, give you wings and say, hey, wow, maybe we can take this position here. Maybe I should. Maybe it's worth it to risk it right now. I'm risking it. I said, you know, hey, do something for me first, and then I'll say it. And it hasn't happened. I said, look, guys, I can't wait any longer. I'm just going to have to trust in you and just say it first. Because, you know, we're running out of time here. I'm you know, almost 60, and that's enough, you know, as far as waiting around for you know, some nice place where like a nice orphanage for me where I feel wanted. You know, it's never happened. I can't wait any longer. I'm not going to wait around anymore. I know the crisis is coming. I can't afford to wait any longer. So I just have to throw caution to the wind and just speak the truth here. And let the chips fall where they may. Maybe there's a few in the world who want to hear this because they know it's true. They know it's true. It's just that, and they realize that, hey, if I see it this way and I'd speak this way, and everyone will abandon me, you know, so they don't want, they kind of bury it, they're hiding it, but they say, I know this is true, yeah, that this is all just a charade, this world. It's just nothing but a charade. It's a ridiculous charade. Human potential is a complete charade. The whole growth potential evolvement thing is absolute charade. It's just decorating a monument to futility. That's all that it is. So, I mean, do we really have to spend our creativity decorating futility? I mean, we can do some decorations. There's nothing that says you can't put up some flowers on the monument to futility. But, yeah, as long as you understand, I'm just my creativity and, you know, it's whimsical silliness, but I'm still being creative, okay. But recognize it's absolute futility. This world, this existence is from the get-go, is simply an exercise in absolute futility. Totally silly, totally whimsical, totally absurd, totally arrogant. And yet our creativity is involved. How could it not? We are creativity. That's what we are. So how can creativity not be involved in this? It is always involved. All through and through. The whole thing is just a creative expression. But no matter how creative we are, we can never reach the self. We can never reach the self. We can never find the self. We never can arrive to the self. We can never pass the self. We can never realize the self. We are the self. There's no realizer of the self. It doesn't exist. We can never reach and realize the self. We can never become the self. We're already that. There's no realizer of the self. How can there be a realizer? We are already being. There's no realizer of being. There's nobody that arrives and says, oh, I finally realized beingness. Doesn't exist. There's no realizer. There's no one that's enlightened. There's no one that says, I finally found the self and now I'm enlightened. That doesn't exist. It's never will. There's no enlightenment. We're already that. Always have been. Now, it's likely there are a few in the world that can hear this and it resonates and they can wow it. Just wow it. They don't analyze it, just wow it. When you wow it, you're accepting that there's no way to reach the self. Which means, wow, I must already be the self. If I can't reach the self and I realize I exist, then I must already be the self. That's the only other conclusion you can draw, right? So you just wow that. Yeah, I really think that this has made me ill as far as getting the nerve, you know, trying to use an excuse not to do it. I think this illness is just an excuse I'm using, a fear excuse to say, well, you know, you're too sick to say this. And it really, because I felt this morning like, should I really even tape? I don't feel so good. And just some vague queasiness and, you know, in the intestines and stomach, just like, inside, just like, I feel lousy. What did I eat? What caused this? You know, but it's really psychosomatic. Of course, everything's psychosomatic. It's just everything. All illness is just an excuse for failure. That's it. It's giving yourself an excuse to fail. So is death. So this is an excuse for failure. Failure. If you don't feel perfect, then you're just making an excuse to fail to accept that you cannot reach the self. Nothing can reach the self. Self is unreachable. So, and yet you're aware, so you must already be the self then. So yeah, this is, you know, it has to be that, doesn't it? All sickness is just fear. It's an excuse, really. I don't even know if you want to call it fear. Continuity fear, but it's really just an excuse. Say, this is why I'm not reaching the self. It's really just arrogance. It's not even fear, it's arrogance. I know Jesus says fear, and so that must be true, a true way of looking at it. I would say also a true way of looking at it is to say that it's arrogance. It's just arrogance. Say, no, I can reach the self. But I'm not reaching it because I'm getting old and I'm dying. If it weren't for that, I'd reach it. Or I just feel sick, or I feel lousy today. If I didn't feel so lousy, I'd be able to reach the self. Okay, so just hear this, that all of your feeling lousiness, down to the last drop, is merely an excuse we're using so that we're claiming this is why we're not reaching the self. The self is reachable, but we're not reaching it because of this. But if you accept the self isn't reachable, you don't need to make any more excuses of why you're not reaching it, why it's not. So all that's not feeling well, all this lousy feeling, can vanish, and you can feel absolutely perfect. Every instant, feel absolutely perfect, because you don't need to make any excuses why you're not reaching the self, because you accept that the self isn't reachable. So gone are all the excuses, gone. And you are the self. And the self that we are is the unreachable self. We are the unreachable self, the unreachable reality. Reality is totally unreachable. So we don't need any excuses of why we can't reach it. And then, so we're in bliss, absolute bliss. Never feel lousy. Jesus said it's entirely possible to seem to walk this world, to be here in this world, and never feel the slightest bit of lousiness at all. Not even the speck of it. You just feel flawlessly, seamlessly, immaculate, perfect. So it's very possible you can do this. Now we know why. And people come in, like the nun my mom, say, Ma, I feel so terrible. What you say is so great. I really want to do it, but This is getting in the way. I mean, I feel awful. Could you have some prayer I can make to remove this obstacle? I got a sickness. That's why I'm not able to reach the self. You know, I really want to reach what you've reached, but I got this illness, sickness. You know, I can't reach it. And she'd just be quiet, and then she'd just laugh. Look at them in this way, you know. What could she do? That's just, you know, ridiculousness, right? I could succeed in doing the impossible, but I got this problem that's preventing me to do so. So could you help me remove this problem so I could do the impossible and reach the self? And so, you know, what you'd have to say gently is, well, look, the self isn't reachable. What are you talking about? You're here to help me reach the self. She says, no, I'm not here to do anything. There's nothing that needs to be done. I'm nobody's guru. I'm not telling you how to reach the self at all. I'm just telling you practice that you're already that. You already are the unreachable reality. We are the unreachable reality. That is what we are. That's what everyone is. So now we know why the teachers kind of look at us like. Like, wow, you know. Patiently say, okay, let's go through this again. You want me to remove this obstacle which is getting in the way of you re re reaching reality, you know. Now let's back off of this for a minute. Let's state reality isn't reachable. Therefore, you don't need to reach it. You are the unreachable reality. Therefore, you certainly don't need any excuses of failing to reach it. Right? Can you see that? But the people, they're so afraid to lose their sicknesses. They say, if I feel perfect, I won't have any excuse. Why I'm failing? So I've got to. I can't do this. Scared. I don't want perfection. I got to have some excuse. I gotta be able to come up with some excuse why I'm failing. Otherwise, I might be, you know, I would. It's tantamount to saying that I'm a total failure and I'll never reach the self. Oh, how horrible that is, you know. No, I've got to make sure I have an excuse, just in case I fail. I can, I won't say no. I'm just a failure. I'll say, well, I failed because I died. That's why. You know, I was still willing to try, but the body, well, it gave out on me. That's why I failed. So I'm not really a failure. I can keep on trying. You see how we make excuses? All these excuses. And we're terrified to be without them. But you see now how this whole thing can be flipped upside down, right? Right side up. Can be flipped right side up. The self is, reality is totally unreachable. So you can't fail to reach it. It's not reachable. So we don't need, we're already there. We are the unreachable reality. So we certainly, why would we need excuses to excuse our failure to reach it when it's not reachable in the first place? So if you keep looking at this, you know, it's going to settle in. Let this just settle in. I'm just doing letting it settle into my saying, wow. Yeah. It's so obvious. I just let it settle. Let the obvious settle in without analysis. This is why I say wow it. Let it settle in without any analysis whatsoever. It doesn't need analysis at all. It's completely self-evident. So I don't know how I'm able to tape like this because I feel lousy and, you know, it's tired, very tired. It's the grace of God, you know, that I pray for help, and I say, I'll do whatever you want me to do. I'll say whatever you want me to say. So I'm just doing it. That's all. And I'm grateful, you know, that I'm able to do this and hear this. I'm just grateful that I'm not so ill that I'm able to do this. Although the illness is trying to come up and, you know, persuade me to stop, actually. Almost persuaded. That's a song, classic country song, Almost Persuaded. A lot of singers covered that. Who did that one? Marty Robbins. Was it John Houston? Houston, someone Houston. They all sang it. They all cover these songs. It's a funny thing, classic country. You might have a song, a nice song's written, and you might have like 10, 20 different singers cover it, put it on their albums. All, you know, sound slightly different. The problem is if George Jones covered a song, it ruined it for everybody else. They said, ah, yeah, it's, what's the use of trying to cover it? It's not going to sound as good. But they still did. It still sounded good. It's a different style, and people still bought their records and enjoyed it. It really, I mean, people were fans of particular country stars. And so whatever they did, you know, they could do no wrong. And these country stars, they just sort of embodied like a certain type. And a certain type of country folk, you know, that they felt down home with. You know, this is someone that really is just like me. And here they are, a star, and they're wearing all these fancy, funny clothes, and singing and playing guitar and music, and oh, you know, we just, it's just like the soundtrack of our life. If I could sing, that's what I would sing about, and that's how I would sing. You know, so they had their following, they had their fans. Porter Wagoner was one, had fans. They had their shows. And people, you know, that was entertainment. They watched these country western shows, television shows, actually had them. And they just enjoyed it. That was entertainment. Wow, entertainment is really gotten pretty intricate, huh? Decorating the monument of futility in new ways. Stick with the old ways. Easy to set them down. Simple, basic, and it doesn't use up so much your mind and your energy and investment as far as I've got to find a way to decorate this new way of decorated. There's just, you know, there's so much stuff that comes out as far as culture goes. I just ignore it all. I don't pay any attention anymore to all the stuff. I stopped quite some time ago. I still at least aware of, like, you know, the Bay Area sporting events. If it's really big, I think the Warriors are, you know, playing for the championship, I think Monday. Yeah, it's going to be a big deal. I might even watch it. You know, maybe some people that you know, be a treat for them to take them just to see it or something, or not to watch it, not to the game. Tickets probably $1,000 a piece. I've never been to a playoff game of any sport whatsoever. Amazing. It's too expensive. Couldn't afford it. I mean, seriously, I just listened to it on the radio. I can't afford to go to games. I've only been one basketball game in my life. Never been to a football game, only been to a few baseball games. I can't afford it. But hey, got better stuff to do, right? Warriors never say die, you know, championship heart. We need to be this way on the spiritual path. Is, you know, even though we're making excuses to fail, realize this is just an excuse I'm using to fail, that's all. To fail to accept. To fail to just say, I am unreachable. Reality is totally unreachable. The self, the one self, is completely unreachable. There's no way to reach it. Just accept this. So all these dream figures we have trying to reach us, they'll never reach us. We're unreachable. They'll always remain just decoration. There'll never be some hero reaching the self. There's no hero that reaches the self. It's impossible. Totally impossible. The self is absolutely unreachable. It's completely free. Where is there to reach? It's nowhere. It's nowhere and everywhere. It's always nowhere and everywhere. There's no label you can affix to it. No definition you can give to it. There's nothing to reach. It's unreachable. Reality is unreachable. Of course, there's it's only a dream figures that are trying to reach it. I mean, they're not really trying. Dream figures aren't really, they're just puppets. We think they're making efforts to try. No, we're projecting the trying upon them. Everything that happens in this world is just a mental projection from spirit onto these stick figures we call bodies. People say the self's unreachable. What are we doing here? Well, there's no we. It's spirit. It's just projecting a dream as if it seems to be outside of spirit, as if it's trying to reach spirit. That's all. There's nothing happening here at all, really. It's like a mirage. Spirit's projecting a mirage of all these phantom figures and phantom stuff, decoration. Just decoration, actually. Just pretty ornamentation, or whatever you want to call it. That's it. And so, you know, we keep going over this and over and talking just so you can realize, hey, someone's saying this. I'm hearing it. I'm listening. I'm agreeing. And you just keep in this ambience, because where else are you going to get it? You know, it's. I don't want to just say it and then run away. You know, like I'm scared. I'm not backing it up. No, I'm backing it up. I'm staying right with it here. It's another reason to make these videos long is. So people will recognize, hey, you know, he's not hit and run. You know, he's not saying it and then say, oh my gosh, what did I say? Yeah, gotta get out of here. You know, we've got to flee for the mountains. No, I'm sticking right here and I'm saying it again. 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 Not going anywhere. So just hang out with that. This is very important. More important than the words is just the fact that we're not running from this. Don't analyze it. Don't analyze. Someone's having a party here in the neighborhood. And marking a coming of age of a young man, and it's a big deal, and the people coming from all over the country, and even people coming from other countries, that, you know, the relatives that are in other countries, they're flying here just for this, to acknowledge the young man's, you know, no longer a child but now a young man, and it's a really big deal. It's going to be, you know, big hoopla, huge. So, people are willing to do this, you know, but are they willing to spend any time with truth? Willing to come to hear truth? I don't know. It's amazing, isn't it? Now, I've been waiting for a guru in the world to come out and say this, and I can't find one. And I can't wait any longer, so I'll have to say it myself. I'll have to be the guru that I want to meet, you know, like that. Now, of course, I do meet gurus, and the subtly, in sleep and dreams, and subtly even while I'm awake here, in waking dreams. But I don't meet any out in life, really, out in what we call this life, you know. So I have to say what I want to hear someone else say. I mean, I've been searching for a guru. I say, look, guru, I want to hear you say something. I need to hear someone in this world say what I, and encourage me and say the right truth. And you know, I haven't been able to find anyone. And so I say, I can't wait any longer. It's just, you know, forget it. I've never had the money. Even if there's some guru somewhere, I don't have the money to travel there anyway. I mean, right now I have actually $0 in my wallet. Nothing. It's empty. Nobody's putting anything in it either. So I can't go. So I have to be the guru that I hope to find. and say what I hope to hear the guru say? Why would I go search for a guru so I could hear someone saying this? You know, and it's not just me. I realize, oh, I'm not crazy. It's not justified that I'm some outcast. You know, it's this is true. What I've always known to be true is really true. But Bhikkhu Longchenpa said this, so that was very helpful. But there's nobody really in the world that is really saying it like this. This is what I can't find them. So, too late, you know, too late. I've run out of time. I don't have any more time to search. I have to say it. And again, I want to hear it. Just no frill, bare bones. This is all there is to it. Plain and simple, that's it. Not this non-dual dance that's done. Not that. No. It's not good enough. Yeah, this truth. Just say, look, as long as you're searching and trying to realize the self, you will suffer all the miseries and sufferings of existence, and you will be reborn and suffer them again, and this will go on forever as long as you're searching for the self. This is a fact. And there's no way around it. You can pray to Jesus or whoever you want to pray to endlessly, and Jesus can do nothing for you in that regard. You know, Jesus can never help you find the self. It's impossible. You are the self. You already are the self. You can never realize the self. There's no realizer of the self. It's impossible. So this is the truth. And economically, you know, you start getting a clientele that wants to believes that you're helping them find the truth, and this becomes a problem. I don't have anybody clientele. You know, I'm not selling anything. I'm not getting any income from any clientele at all. Nothing. Zero. Zero. Not a penny. Not a penny. And I have nothing for sale at all. So I don't have a business at all. So what do I have to lose? You know, what do I have to lose? I mean, the clientele abandoned me. They weren't paying anything anyway. I'm not losing anything in terms of economically. If everyone abandons these transmissions here, well, it doesn't. I'm not out a penny. You know. People can download all my graphics, everything for free. These videos are for free. Everything I do, it's for free. This way, I'm able to speak the truth. I mean, it would be a hindrance if I was getting anything, that's for sure. Now, if I'm really able to witness the truth, and then pragmatically something would help out, I don't know if that's another story or not. I don't know. But in terms of speaking the truth here, if you have a clientele you're dependent on, it's almost certain that they, deep down, they believe that you have the secret of how to reach the self. And that's why they're your clientele. And the last thing they want to believe is that not that you don't know how to reach the self, is that you're saying that the self is unreachable. I didn't reach the self. How could I do the impossible? That's ridiculous. I just gave up trying to reach the self. And so I'm just abiding as the self, not as one who has reached the self. That's the last thing they want to hear. So if you want to be, you know, a big wig, big shot in the world, let everybody believe that you know how to reach the self, and give them all sorts of you know, sell them all sorts of stuff that they feel they're by investing in this, that somehow this empowers it. It provides an excuse to succeed. It provides, well, I spent so much, I have to succeed. You know, there's no way that reality can deny me success because I've spent a lot of money on it. So I have to succeed. It's valuable now. And reality can't overlook value, they think, like that. I've been having a lot of flashbacks of when I was younger, just a feeling sort of thing. Not words or who was there or some experience I had, but kind of a feeling like, oh, so that's how I used to feel. Back when I had some hope that people would listen. Back before the world, you know, finally crushed me and pushed me into graduated effort. I got to reach the self. I got to help people understand how to reach the self. The self's so wonderful. They're all working so hard to reach it. I got to help them reach it. You know, before I fell into that delusion. Excuse, I just drifted off. That's an excuse. Okay, that's all it is. Just look at it that way. Don't analyze it. We already know what it is. It's an excuse to fail. We're giving ourselves an excuse to fail. To excuse failure. It's a way to excuse failure. Instead of recognizing that there's no, it's impossible. Therefore, you can't say that I'm failing. How could you say you're failing when something's impossible? That's ridiculous. So it's a way to excuse failure. We think I'm failing because I'm tired. I drifted off. I'm this. I'm a man. I'm a woman. I'm old. I'm young. You know, I'm busy. I'm sick. I'm dying. These are all excuses. We're projecting these excuses on the body. The body is neutral. We're just projecting all this stuff. We're projecting needs. I have this need. That's a projection. All of this is projection. Did I fall asleep for a long time here? Because it shows 140, 145. How? I haven't been talking that long. Maybe I fell asleep. I don't know. I don't remember. Maybe not. I don't know. How could it be 1:46 already? Is that true? What time is it? 1:49. I must have started taping just after noon. Yeah. Wow. Again, these excuses, the body, I'm in such great shape. I know that this body, this has to be an excuse, does it not? Yeah. How can I be in such great shape and feel so sluggish and weak? It's an excuse. Like I've been saying, I've been nervous and depressed, really almost like weeping, just feeling like I've spent my whole life as an orphan, and now I have to say this, and the rest of my life, I'm going to be seen as persona non grata. It's just, it's really tough to do. Maybe that's why I was weeping. I went in that dream of Longchenpa on the coaching on the sideline. I was in the gym. I was the only one there that wasn't a coach, and I just started weeping. You know, I just said, "Wow, you know, really." I still have to go it alone like this? This is just, you know, wow. Well, interesting. Well, this is, what other road can I take, you know? It's the only road there is, the no road. There is no road to the self. It doesn't exist. This is how we have to practice. Hearing this is the right way to practice, actually. We're not practicing to be ourselves. We're just practicing letting go of all attempt to be ourselves. You see, this is what it is. We're letting go of effort. Ramana said, "Practice is we're making effort to let go of effort." This is, they all say this. Okay, this, we practice to let go of practice, make effort to let go of effort. We're so addicted to it. We need to practice letting go of it. It's like we're holding on to this balloon. Say, okay, now we need to practice. Relax the thumb, relax the finger, relax this, you know. Very interesting. That dream I had, this dream of this little girl who got hit by a car. I was walking along, we were walking along the street, and she was kind of dancing or just moving, you know, just really wonderfully, not just some robotic way, very non-robotic. And she kind of went to her side, the left side there, and this car hit her on the left side. That was like going way too close to the people on the side. They were walking, and it was like hit her and knocked her quite some distance, and looked like her right arm was torn from her body, and it was a horrible accident. And I called emergency, and we got her to a hospital, and I was there. I prayed over her body for so much. I was praying, you know, I said, "You're gonna make it. You know, you're gonna make it. I refuse to allow you not to make it." As I was just, I just took everything I had to believe that, you know, she was going to be all right, because we all thought she was dead for sure. I said, "No, you're not dead. You're going to make it. We're going to have a miracle here. It's going to happen." And finally, the dream, through all these great efforts, she finally was able to at least talk with me in a whisper, you know, quiet whisper, said, "Yeah, I'm okay. I'm here. I realize I'm okay." Very quiet whisper like this. She was still kind of not moving around, immobile, but was talking. And then I saw her body was okay. And the only thing that was a trouble, I noticed her finger, one of her fingers was such that it was hurt. Her fingers had been hurt, so she couldn't really grasp anything. Looks like she couldn't grasp anything. I was thinking, "Uh-oh, wow. Well, how can we fix that?" I said, "It didn't look fixable. I think that's going to be permanent." I said, "Well, okay, I'll accept that. Well, maybe this was the self. And this little girl symbolizes the divine child. and there's nothing to grasp. There is no realization of the self. There is no enlightenment. So this whole dream was showing me my life, how I seem to have been impacted so badly by those who were intent upon the path. The car was going along this, you know, road fast and so intently, it wasn't even, didn't even see the little girl there and hit her. And knocked her unconscious almost, right? And then I've been trying to resuscitate this. So in other words, this divine child got knocked unconscious here in the world. So I've been trying to resuscitate this message, and I've been working so hard my whole life, and now I'm just able to whisper, and there was like communication. I can talk with her. You know, it's like, wow. You can talk. We can communicate. You're alive. Yeah, but they cannot grasp anything. Well, there's nothing to grasp. Reality is not graspable. It's not understandable. It's not reachable at all. And so maybe that symbolized it. Wow. That's one way of looking at it. There's other ways of looking at it, but this seems to resonate pretty strongly with me here. Very traumatic dream. Maybe it's a recapitulation of my life, and now I'm sure that finally there's success coming, and that the self is alive and is communicating with me, meaning I'm able to speak the words that it wants me to speak, in terms of just it's not reachable. There's no understanding of the self at all. There's no reachability of it at all. There's not even a real recognition or realization or attainment or of it. There's no enlightenment at all. None of this is true. It's just a silly dream. The self is completely unreachable. Maybe now the little girl can sit up, and it's at that point. It's able to speak, and maybe it can now just sit up and with its eyes open and speak very softly and quietly. Maybe people can come visit the little girl, right? The divine child. Possible. I'm just sort of like the perfunctory adult, you know, that people want to see. Is there an adult in the room? Is there someone at least seems as though that they've made some effort to reach the self? Okay. At least that helps our continuity fear a little bit, you know. They think she's so retarded. Oh, you had a terrible accident. That's why you speak so softly. And you can't grasp anything now because you are injured. And you just sit there quietly because this injury has traumatized you, you know. So, in other words, they want an excuse why they couldn't relate to the divine child. So this accident seemed to take place. I went to an event today, and I was all dressed in white. White cargo shorts, white long sleeve shirt. I wore black shoes just to show I'm still in the world, you know. I mean, pragmatically, it's a soccer game, youth soccer game, and I don't want to trudge through all the wet grass and everything in these real white fabric shoes. They're gonna ruin them, you know. Those are for indoors. So, you know, I wore black work running shoes, and first time I've gone like an all whites like this to some event. That's fine, no problem. People kind of looked at me like, wow. A little bit like, very striking, you know. No patterns, no colors. Everybody's wearing t-shirts or clothes that a lot of people have these sayings and banners and designs on their t-shirts. Everybody's wearing stuff that says lettering and labeling. Everybody's got clothing that has labeling on it. Here, as far as I can tell, like there's no labeling, hardly. You know, it might be a little something on the back or something, but virtually, you know, zero labeling, just white. says it symbolizes no labels. No labels, no definitions. But nobody really paid any attention to me. Nobody came up to me and said hello or anything. Kind of like, who's he? I'm not comfortable. I'm not sure how to label him. Right? I'm not really sure how to label him, so I don't know what to say. I've got to find a label for him. People are wearing labels all over. Like, tattoos are labels, right? I gotta label myself. I gotta tattoo myself. Only way I can feel comfortable is I make sure the self is labelable, of course. Look, I just tattoo my body. It just proves it's labelable. It is labelable. Of course it's labelable, they say. I got a tattoo. It proves it. Kids were great. Played real intensely, intelligently, nobly. Some got injured. They got up. I mean, these are young, tough kids that are really smart, and they're really, it's a good crop of kids, but it's the same as ever, right? No truth here. There's a lot of good kids, but they're going into they're being raised in a wicked culture, as far as a spiritually ignorant culture of endeavor and belief and attainment and all this. They used to say, "Ananda, my ears, you got so much attainment, it's unbelievable." She goes, "I don't have any attainment. I'm just a little child. I have no realization. I have no enlightenment. I have done nothing." Jesus says we need to do nothing at all. When we realize we need to do nothing at all, this is the key. He says that is what you're aiming for, is when you can say, I need to do nothing. Nothing at all. I am nothing at all, and I need to do nothing at all. To reach this nothing at allness. It says you're then that this, the unlabelableness, the acceptance of I am unreachableness, I am the unreachableness, it's right there. It's you're about to experience this. This is about to be experienced. And so we're right there. Using words pragmatically. Of course, if you want to confound it all, you can say, hey, level confusion if you want to, but there's no level confusion here. What we're saying is very clear. Don't confuse level confusion with confusion or excuse making. If you want to make an excuse, you could always say, I don't understand what you're saying. No, I understand what I'm saying perfectly well. It's easy to understand it. Not to not understand it is just making excuses for failure. Say, I'm not reaching the self because I'm not understanding what's being said here. If they just spoke clearly, I would be able to reach the self. I'd understand how to do it. There is no doing it. There's no doing it. There's no reaching it. Reality is unreachable. So realize everything we're experiencing is a mental projection to excuse failure. But excusing failure and failure are the same coin of believing that that reality is reachable, and it's not reachable. So how can we fail to reach it, and how can we make excuses to fail to reach it? It's all ridiculous. We can't fail to reach it. It's not reachable. Because to fail implies there's a way to succeed. Otherwise, it's a meaningless term, isn't it? Totally meaningless. Failure only takes its meaning because the belief the opposite is possible, that success is possible. And success only takes its meaning if failures are possible. So this is why we say that concepts are dualistic. But what we are is beyond concepts and dualism. We've never been there. We've never been reachable. It's not that we were reachable and then we fell from grace and became unreachable. That's a lie. We've never been reachable. Reality's never been reachable in any way. And there's never been anyone to reach it either. So, there you have it. Again and again and again. Again and again and again. June 11th, right? 43 days till D-Day. We're already sidestepping it, though. By speaking up like this and listening to this, you're already sidestepping it. That's it. You're already sidestepping it. Just accept the self is not reachable at all. It's completely, no one has ever reached it, no one ever will. There's no one actually to reach it. It's completely unreachable because it's absolute freedom. There's no label for it or definition for it at all. God is unreachable. Again, even God cannot reach God. Even spirit cannot reach spirit. You know, we cannot reach God. God is unreachable. We're unreachable. Everything is unreachable. We are the unreachable one. We are the one unreachableness. Just hear that and accept it more and more. You're sidestepping the troubles. Just that's it. That is sidestepping the troubles. You see, it's mental, isn't it? The sidestepping is this ideational work we're doing here. Birds are chirping away on this ridiculously beautiful California day. It's just, you know, you actually wonder here whether you're in a dream or not. A lot of times I think, am I dreaming this? It's got to be a dream, right? Maybe California helps in that way. It seems surreal, actually, very surreal. Because most places are not, you know, this beautiful. The weather, the atmosphere, it gives a beauty to everything. It gives a gentleness, a soft, beautiful gentleness to everything. It just, so it has a dreamlike quality to it, most definitely does. You know, that the humidity is not a problem. It's not like it's humid, or it's not too dry, or it's not too cold, or it's not too hot. It's not too this or too that. It just seems to be this happy place. And so you just look at a plant and you say, oh, it's a happy plant. Because you think the atmosphere is so happy that you think everything is just feeling this happy atmosphere. And again, you can pinch yourself like this. I think this might just be a dream. It's funny because I never really identify with California as a real place. To me, it seems like a dream. I say, ah, I don't trust in it. I say, this is just a dream. Yeah, it's just a dream, really. So I've never really feel like, yeah, I'm in this place. You know, I say, no. I'm just looking at a dream here, actually. And this is just a dream. So it might be very spiritually helpful in that way, actually. It's like everything is just too perfect here. I said, I don't think this is the world. This must be a dream. This morning, what a gorgeous morning it was. Wow. Clear with all these sort of soft striated clouds on the horizon. It just with decoration and so balmy and a soft, cool breeze, but you could feel the warmth of the sun coming in the morning, and it's just like, I mentioned to somebody, I said, this is like, it's like a perfect day. I said, yeah, it's just perfect. It's like, just really, really nice. Wow. It is that way. So, is it real, or is it a dream? We say real. I mean, is it real effort? To, you know, it's like a lack of excuses here, kind of. You know, with the harsh conditions, they say, "Well, I got an excuse, so I'm not, you know, failing because this place is terrible." But in California, it's like you don't really have an excuse to fail. It's like I keep thinking, "Why am I failing? I mean, it's not California. It's not this. It must be me. But why am I failing?" So California has kind of removed this excuse to fail. It really does. So I'm like, wow, what's wrong with me? It can't be the weather. It can't be the plants. It can't be this place. It can't be that. It's got to be something else. So in that way, I'd say California is very helpful. The teams here winning all these championships, it can't be that. You know, the people are so affluent, it can't be that. So what is it? Why am I failing? Why do I feel like a failure? So you have to battle through the fatigue, the sickness, and all that, and just keep on practicing. Like the reality is unreachable. Reality is totally unreachable. And that's okay. Reality is totally unreachable. There's no one outside of reality that needs to reach it. There's nothing outside of reality that needs to reach it. So being totally unreachable is great. And excuses will arise, or just notice them. That's all. That's all you have to do. Don't analyze them. Just notice. Okay, I'm sleepy. Okay, that's an excuse. I'm trying to excuse failure. There is no failure. There's just impossibility. Reality's not reachable. So that happens. You just recognize it, and then just go back. Say, okay, I don't need that excuse. I don't need any excuses. Just let it go. Let it go. All these clouds in the sky are like excuses. Just all the thoughts are just excuses. All this decoration of the monument of futility is just a monument to excuses. Futility, a monument to excuses. Really, I mean, if something's impossible, we try to do it. What can we do except make excuses? Actually, isn't that all this, all that existence is, just an excuse, a monument to excuses? Yeah, it is. And our excuse making will take place. It does. I'm experiencing it. You drift off and some completely, oblivious to what we've been talking about here. Your thoughts will just be oblivious. Excuses are oblivious to this. So all your excuses are just oblivious to this fact that reality is not reachable. They're oblivious to it. So why give them any preference, one over the other? That's all equal obliviousness. They're all just excuses of trying to, excuse our failure to reach reality. Reality is not reachable, so why worry about cloud formations? It's just various varieties of excuses, which are infinite excuses we can make. Infinite. So just let all the cloud forms, all the thought forms play however they want to play. Don't pay any attention to them. Getting pretty close to the end now, aren't we? Are we? I don't know. It's hard to see. Not maybe not. Oh yeah, a little ways to go. So I'm just hanging in here like this and experiencing how our thoughts will drift off, how our excuses will come up. Of course they will. Of course they will. But we're getting wise to them, aren't we? And when we don't need to make any more excuses, we realize, then we'll be awake, so to speak. We won't drift off. The drifting continues. There's just this constant stream of drifting thoughts, thought forms. But we don't have to pay attention to them. We don't fixate on one and get lost in it and think, oh yeah, I'm going to sleep now. I'm dreaming about this. I'm thinking all of that dream, just let it, like the surface of the ocean, just let the surface play however it wants to play. These are just excuses. trying to excuse failure, that's all. Or trying to say that failure's happening because of these excuses that are getting in the way of a success. That's what it's really saying. So we don't, at some point we'll just not need to feel no need to pay attention to any of that and just stay in this pristine, blissful awareness. Maybe, well, not maybe, soon we'll do it. There you go, soon we'll do it. Because the excuses that are coming up are horrible. I mean, you talk about excuses. Everybody is working frantically on excuses in this world, almost everyone. They're working frantically on excuses. So they can say, well, of course I got to reach the self, but look at all this trouble. I mean, how could you possibly say I can't reach the self? I mean, it's the trouble. If this trouble wasn't here, it'd be a whole different story. You know, but look at all the trouble that's here. You can't draw a conclusion. You can't reach the self under these circumstances. Come on. So this is the kind of rhetoric that's been set up here. And we're expected to go along with all this excuse making here. Because they say there's good excuses, come on, these are the best excuses we have. If you don't have that, you won't have any good excuses at all. You don't want to be stuck with no excuses, because then it'll mean you're a failure. No, it won't. It means that there's no possibility of success, so there can't be a failure. There's just the impossibility. There's no one to reach reality. All reality, there's just one reality, and all of it is unreachable. So, there's nothing bad, there's no trauma in that at all. There's no failure in that at all. Reality is failure-free, actually. The failure-free, unreachable reality, and we are it. All is it. All is it. So just keep bringing yourself back to the truth, and don't struggle with these excuses. Don't try to make excuses for excuses. Don't try to say, well, I don't want to use that excuse, so let me try to get rid of that excuse. Well, the excuses are infinite, so that's a waste of time to do it that way. Just bring yourself right back that you don't need excuses. You don't need to excuse failure, because there is no failure, because there's no success. Failure, success don't exist. Reality is just this one unreachableness, this one seamless unreachableness. I am absolutely unreachable. All is absolutely unreachable. And speaking of reaching, in the dream we keep all this reaching is everywhere, and we're about to reach the end of this video, for instance, right? Because the software has limitations. It's 4 gigabytes. That's it. I don't know why to settle on 4 gigabytes, but it did. So we're so used to reaching. Everything we do here is reaching, is it not? Reaching for our next breath. So I'm having all these troubles, achy back and stuff, that are trying to say, hey, don't tape. You got a great excuse not to tape, not to say this. And again, the body's not making these excuses. The mind's projecting this on the body. Everything the body seems to be experiencing is a mental projection. Everything psychosomatic. Everything, as far as the body goes. Body's just inert, neutral inertness, basically. It's just a stick figure, a dream stick figure. Doesn't have any qualities of its own. We project upon it. Health, we project upon it. Fatigue, we project upon it. We project health, say, oh, I'm too healthy to quit. You know, I mean, look how strong and healthy I am. I can't quit. There must be a way to succeed. That's another excuse. I'm not I'm not accepting the unreachableness reality because I feel so healthy that I feel like there must be a way to do it. I can't stop. I feel too good to stop in that way. But whereas bliss is something different, it's Jesus said you don't really feel the body at all in terms of health or non-health, attainment or non-attainment. You just feel a steady, seamless bliss. See, a bliss of awareness, the bliss of awareness, the unreachable bliss. It's the unreachableness. We're experiencing the unreachableness. So you wouldn't know, but there's a huge party going to be happening here at some point soon. Yeah. Not right here, but very nearby. All is quiet right now, right? So if you just look at this date, well, a couple hours from now, you know, it's just going to be big, big, big hoopla taking place right here. So how can we say, we look at the future, say, oh, no, everything will be quiet, nice and quiet here in the world? Really? Maybe a huge party will break out of some sort, right? A global happening will happen. Troubles, you know, excuses will break out. Massive buffet of excuses. A smorgasbord of excuses will just bust out suddenly. It's an enchanting day. The atmosphere is very enchanting. But we're beyond enchantment and non-enchantment. And we're reaching an end here of the video, but reality is unreachable. Reality is unreachable. Reality is unreachable. I'm saying it. You're hearing it. Get used to hearing this as a huge step forward. Now, you may find in your life all sorts of excuses arising for you not to watch, not to pay attention, not to hear this, not to consider it, not to say it yourself. It's almost a certainty that they are. Many, many excuses are coming up. So you can say, well, I would have, but I, you know, this stuff happened. There are terrible excuses. A lot of excuses have come up for me recently, and I've just refused to use them. You know, people say, well, a good excuse is a terrible thing to waste. No, it's a great thing to waste. That's what we're supposed to do. All these great excuses we have, we're supposed to just say, not now, maybe later I'll use that one, but not right now. And just perpetually keep doing that. Not now, maybe later I'll use that excuse. I've had many very enticing excuses come up recently. And fortunately, hopefully, I've not, you know, employed them. My cat showed up in a dream a couple days ago. That's usually a portent of something very significant. The blissful cat. The cat was a personification of bliss, actually. No effort to label anything. No effort to attain anything. Cat made no effort to attain anything. It just lay there, just sat there, it just stretched out in total bliss. If you called it by names, anything, no response. I'm in bliss. It wouldn't let anything get in the way of bliss, of its bliss. It just lie there, you know, just stretched out. Totally stretch out, hind legs and front legs just stretched out both, so it seemed like it was like 3 foot long or something. It was amazing. Big cat, a big bone cat, and it just would just absolutely still just lay there and just, if you try to talk to it, it would just start purring. If you touch it, it would just start purring. It says, I'm perfectly happy. You don't need to do anything for me. His whole life it was like this. It was the blissful cat. It wasn't like normal cats. I mean, normal cats are blissful at times or not, but this one seemed to just be, that's just what it was about, constantly. And it's returned to me in dreams numerous times. I've visited with this cat in dreams after it's passed away. This time it was just stretched out in bliss here, right near where we're taping. Didn't say anything, just remained in bliss. Yeah, we're reaching it. Yeah, we're reaching it. But we don't remember, there's nothing to reach. Reality is not reachable at all. We are not reachable. We are not findable. We are not attainable. We're not recognizable. We're not realizable. We're unfindable. We're absolutely unfindable. Of course, we don't need to find, because we are. We are the unfindableness. The unfindableness doesn't need to find itself to be the unfindableness. No, the unfindableness is the unfindableness. The unreachableness is the unreachableness. And here we go. Here we go. Just abide in that.